The public hearing is now open. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to address this issue?
Any commissioners?
Little bit of the background on this. We were approached by representatives of the Public Finance Authority of Wisconsin to do a multi-state tax exempt bond financing. They have to get approval from the governing body of the project home, which they have a project in Garden City. It's located on at 2708 North 11th Street. So what you are approving here would be a resolution that shows you're in agreement with this type of financing for Mosaic. It is not any sort of obligation of the city of Garden City. It's just to show that you are approving their So you could go on to the resolution that you need to pass.
Close the public hearing in November?
Yeah.
Yes.
Anything else?
That's all I have.
All right, we'll close the public hearing. Any discussion by the commissioners?
And again, the most important thing, I guess, is this doesn't obligate the city in any way.
No.
To debt repayment.
No.
Or if they would default.
I'll make a motion that we approve the resolution.
2704-2017. Is that a motion? Do we have a second?
Second.
Got a motion from Matt Bankhauser, a second from Commissioner Law. Governing it for, I assume that would be for number one. Resolution. If so, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. Motion carried 5-0.
Thank you.
Okay, Mayor, at this time we'll go back to item number four, which is approval of the minutes from the last regular meeting.
I didn't see any changes.
Approve is
presented. The minutes from the June 6, 2017 meeting were included in your packet. Are there any corrections? Hearing none, these minutes stand approved as presented.
Mayor and commissioners, I have something to add to the agenda. At yesterday's Finney County Commission meeting, the commission asked that you give consideration to affirming or approving the use of the joint city-county economic development funds for the improvement of Farmland Road. So if that's something that you want to do, I'd suggest that you consider it after Ms. Duvall's report at 12G on the agenda.
We're on to item number five, which is the public comment. We have 30 minutes, 5 minutes for each spokesperson, and that would be things not already on the agenda.
Okay, I want to open the public comments agenda, the section of the meeting preserves for everyone attending wanting to address the commission about something that is otherwise not on the agenda. Anybody wish to come forth? State your name, please.
Yes, my name is Jeff Crisp, resident here in town, and I came to a public forum, which was a town hall meeting. I missed the last one. I just want to express my gratitude to the commissioners. I had come requesting that there were some trees removed for my grandfather's grave, and that has happened. The cemetery crew has done a tremendous job. They planted some grass there. Looks great. First time I went over there, I drove by because I didn't see the trees. But I've got accustomed to it now. But I want you to know, really appreciative. I did, per Kelly's request, give a donation, get a gift certificate so that he could plant a couple of trees anywhere in the cemetery he wanted. on the cemetery, not here to represent the hospital, but the spiritual care department holds their infant interment once a year. We did that this last week, and I just want to commend Kelly and his crew for the help that we get, and the city too, certainly, but just I'm very appreciative. Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you. Yeah,
thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Those were great comments, and we accept all those, and we're happy that we do have a cemetery, and Kelly and Andy, who take care of the grounds and stuff, that it is what it is, and so we can be proud of it. Thank you for the donation of the trees that will go back in. Thank you. Anybody else? Okay. Close the public comment.
On to item 6A, the governing body is asked to consider and approve a request from the Finney County Historical Society for a waiver of the sign ordinance and fee for three signs to be placed at 3rd Street and Kansas Avenue, Main Street Zoo Entrance, and the North Zoo Fence west of the museum from July 2nd through 10th of 2017.
And this is what we've done before. Commence, right?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
I'll make the motion that we approve the request.
Second.
We had a motion and a second. Any discussion? If not, all in favor of the sign permits for what activity was this?
Leavenworth.
Okay. And the following location listed in the letter here. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed say nay. Carried. 5-0.
Item 6B. The governing body is asked to consider and approve a request from Garden City Wind and St. Catherine Hospital for approval of an aircraft landing in the corporate limits of the city on July 4th, 2017 between 6 and 6:30 p.m. at Clint Leitner Field pursuant to code section 14-71.
So moved.
I'll second.
Any other discussion? If none, we've had a motion to have approval to land a helicopter at Clint Leitner Field on July the 4th, 2017. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. Carried 5-0.
At this time, we'll move on to 7A. Assistant Director of Neighborhood and Development Services will present details of the new trailhead signs. Carol?
Good afternoon. I just would like to give you an update. Live Well Finney County Community Health Coalition received a grant. It was the Chronic Disease Risk Reduction Grant. And they have donated some of the monies from that grant to the City of Garden City for the purpose of putting in trailhead signs for the trails that we have in our city. We currently don't have any. We have taken that money. The total amount that they have donated to the city is passed over to the city is $40,557. And of that, $12,182 is dedicated for signs. So we will be putting in 13 signs. They will be for Tally Trail, Dean Wiley Park, and Finnup Park. There will be 7 signs put up on all along Tally Trail, 5 in the Finnup Park area, and then 1 at Dean Wiley. The signs in the packet, I believe you had an example of the Tally and Finnup Park signs. The signs will show the pathway that, for example, the Finnup Park trail is a loop around Finnup Park. It will show that. It will describe the distances. There's several different distances in every one of the trails on all of the maps. The signs will also, something that's pretty modern and unique, that's kind of fun. Every map will have a QR code on it so that anyone passing by can scan it with their phone, and then that will link them directly to an Explore My Community link, and this is done through the GIS department. And they've got, through that link, you can get additional information about other parks in the city that they can go to, different things that are going on, bus stops, when the bus, schedules, things like that. So just a kind of neat little item there on our maps. We will also have a larger map down at the bottom that will show every trail in Garden City. So if somebody's on one trail, they could say, oh, there's another trail down there, and let's go check it out. Along with this, the sign, the money used for the signs, we're going to put in trail markers, which are basically a mile marker. We're going to put them in every half mile on Tally Trail and then the Bennett Park Trail. So that will help anyone using those trails to know, you know, how far they've gone and for their physical exercise that day. So we're really excited about it. We're in the process right now of ordering them, and there's no action to take. I just wanted to give you an update on this. So look forward to these signs coming up soon.
Sounds good. Thank you.
From there, items 7B through 7J include your staff reports from the airport, the cemetery, your financial report from service and finance, fire department, building report, compliance report from neighborhood and development services, master activity from the police department, ridership, and Lee Richardson Zoo. If we could move directly to 7K, Public Works Director Sam Curran will present plans for resurfacing the Bennett Park Court, scheduled for June 26, 2017 through June 30th of 2017. If he's gonna be here. If not, I think the main purpose of this was to update the community so the community would be aware of when they were going to be resurfaced. This period of time, there's a sign down there that for the basketball courts, and they've posted notice on those, but for those that are using them, in case they're unaware or in case they don't see the sign posted there, they wanted to make sure that it got on this meeting and on to Channel 8 so that people know that those courts will be closed during that resurfacing period. Are there any questions? If he comes, he can maybe further update that, but that's generally what the purpose of that portion was.
Sounds good.
Okay. Item 8 is meetings of note. There are several on there, and if there's any that need to, or any that require RSVP, please make sure that you get that to Celine. Yes.
I know, is it the 27th that we start, that they open up the fireworks, I think?
Mm-hmm. Right, Chief?
I believe it's the
27th, and that goes through the 5th. So 10:30 to 10:30, right, each day? Okay. And you guys will be going out to kind of talk to the vendors like you did last year again and
yes.
Everything. So, okay. Sounds good. Thank you.
Anything else on the meetings of note? Okay. Move on to 9A, Appropriation Ordinance number 2437-2017A.
That's me. I move that we approve the appropriations ordinance 2437-2017A.
Second. We've had a second and a motion and approval. We've had a motion and we've had a second for appropriation ordinance 2437-2017A. Any discussion? If none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay.
Mayor, is that Commissioner Law that seconded?
That meeting is at 9 a.m. in the morning.
Oh, July 6th.
July 6th.
Yes.
So don't forget.
To the
9 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes. Correct.
I kind of forgot.
We don't have any ordinances or resolutions or old business, so we'll move on to item number 12, which is new business, and we've completed section A, so we'll move on to section B. Executive Director of Downtown Vision, Micah Bunch, will provide an update to the governing body.
Good afternoon, Aaron, Commissioners. Thanks for having us here today. Things are really, I had a presentation, but it's mine, maybe we don't. Okay, that's no problem. Things are really becoming active, and really the summer months really start bringing people out and around downtown. So. Sorry, I had a presentation. So currently, Downtown Vision has 96 members.
We've got it on ours.
Okay, well, perfect.
We can.
That's all I needed. So we currently have 96 members for $48,000, a little over $48,000 in membership drives. The board has just launched a board-driven membership drive, so we're going to try to increase that over the remainder of the year. We have had two new businesses open in the downtown area this year, Frank's Computer Shop on Main Street, and then Fashion Girls Boutique, which is on 8th Street. We have recently completed market study focus groups, which we gained a lot of really good input from business owners, property owners, businesses in the service sector. The information that we gave, I'm going to keep going. There we go.
Okay.
So the focus groups, we gained a lot of information. Something that was really important that came out of that was we heard from a lot of businesses that the liquor by the drink was maybe business prohibitive a little bit to them. And so as you've seen in, from that feedback in those market focus groups, trying to make some, you know, work on that and see what we can do to maybe make, you know, change those laws a little bit and make it to where it's a little more business friendly. We had some really good meetings with business owners on 8th Street. Those were probably one of the focus groups that we just gleaned a lot of information. Something that the 8th Street businesses really told us is, as it is right now, they don't really feel included when we say downtown, and they want to be. They want the aesthetic upgrades. They want the, you know, just everything that we incorporate in downtown. They'd love to have the events. We have worked with quite a few of them recently to get them involved with our incentive programs. We've had two 8th Street businesses apply and be approved for it. We have another one coming up. So excited to work with them and see what we can do on 8th Street. Our master plan is full of projects that are all about 8th Street. And so I think there's a real opportunity there to include them and expand on 8th Street. And the businesses that have been there are successful. We're opening new ones over there, and they're long-time businesses. They're doing a really good job over there, and so we need to appreciate that and include them a little bit more in some of the things that we're doing. Some other things that came out of those focus groups was the potential to create either a CID, a BID, a citywide sales tax, or whatever that may be for the downtown area, and not one business owner or property owner that we talked to said that they would be opposed to that. They were all like, yeah, we'd like to look at that. We'd like to see what that looks like. So our business development committee and design committee, we're gonna explore those opportunities a little bit more and see kind of what that looks like. Again, going back to the master plan, it is full of projects that community input has said that they'd like to see in the area. So definitely something that we're gonna take a look at. Incentive funds. Our IWW right now is currently serving 7 loans totaling over $96,000. So that's it's been a really good incentive fund. You'd probably be hard pressed to find a business downtown that's not taking advantage of that. So it's done good. It's a revolving fund. It's going to keep being there. Jumpstart is one that we've awarded one applicant on that. We still have funds available for that. And that's the program that covers 50% of rent and utilities for a retail-based business the first year, 25% the second year. So great opportunity for someone to take advantage of that. Of course, we have Downtown Development Fund, which we can't thank the city enough for that. We're currently working with 8 potential business clients right now that are looking to take advantage of our incentive funds or locate downtown or something like that. So it's like when we turn the corner on the summer months, people just want to start coming downtown, and we're super excited to have them. So new businesses that will be opening by the end of the year. Roots Juice, the wellness company. Goodness, there's not a day that goes by that someone doesn't say, when is Roots going to open? I think we've sampled almost every single one of Alicia's drinks, and so we're very happy to do that. It's generated so much enthusiasm for community members. I'm really excited to have that one down here. The other ones, Tetra Serenity Massage and Central Cup Coffee, they'll be opening later towards the end of the year. There's been kind of some delays with construction, and you know, it's a pretty busy time. And then Patrick Dugan's Coffee House expansion. Well, I don't know anyone that's probably not excited about that. So, and hopefully, I talked to Cassie today, and she's like, I'm not giving anyone else an exact date because, you know, construction, you just never can bank on it. So we're excited to have them in the downtown area, and hopefully more to come. So that will be really exciting. Our design committee has really been working hard on Heroes Way expansion. We have found an architect that will work with us, so super excited about that. We've got big maps. We are like narrowing down to what, you know, types of development there that we think that would work the best, and just really trying to put a face to this project so it can grow some roots and it would be just a great asset to the downtown community. We, again, talking about downtown aesthetics, we've been working a lot with 8th Street businesses. They want to see, and not only 8th Street businesses, the businesses further to the north on Main. A piece of feedback that we got from the focus group was, after Stevens Park, the businesses down there, they don't really feel incorporated into downtown. They're like, the aesthetics stop, and if you're driving through, you may not realize that all the way to Kansas Avenue includes downtown. So what can we do to help them feel incorporated, include them in more activities, promote those businesses? That's something that we're really working on a lot. CIP projects is another thing that the design committee is looking at. A lot of our CIP projects have been on there. One of them has been on there since 1992. So I think it's time for us to look at our CIP projects and reevaluate what we're asking for. I have a list of about 20 projects that I think would be good CIP fits. It's our wish list, and it could be some really good things for the downtown. Promotions committee, who doesn't love promotions? Our events downtown they've attracted a good amount of people. We're coming off a very successful weekend with the Let's Go Retro events. The car show in Stevens Park was very successful. I know that some people were very nervous about parking the cars in Stevens Park. The group that we worked with on that, Kansas Cruisers, they took absolutely every precaution to make sure that park was wonderfully taken care of. They had a live band. We had a lot of traffic downtown. The stores were happy. They had a above average Saturday, the ones that we've spoken to so far, and so they're very happy with that. It was hot. I can definitely say that as the day went on, attendance started getting a little lower, and I don't blame them a bit. So we are introducing Fall Fest. I tasked Amy Warfield, works with us in the office, and I kind of tasked her this year to, let's just start really looking at Fall Fest vendors. What can we do to really grow this? And last year about this time, we maybe had 7 or 8 vendors registered. We're over 35 right now, and 25 of those are brand new vendors to the event that will bring something that we've not seen before. So hopefully we'll be able to use all of Main Street this year and into Stevens Park, and I'm not opposed to someday, using the side streets and just making this a really fun community event. So that would be great. Banner Art, the art walk, is set for August 19th downtown. We have 25 artists, 50 banners. This is the 10th year anniversary, so we're really excited about that. And the auction will be November 4th. And First Fridays, we are introducing this year First Fridays. In the first 24 hours that we posted that event on social media, it was shared several hundred times and has been our highest performing post and engagement that we've had in the time I've been downtown. It's like every 5 minutes my phone is going off. People will love their food trucks. So we're excited to see how it goes and how we can expand and grow on that. And
how many trucks are going to be there?
Well, this first time around, I was working with some, I'd really like to keep it to 10, just to kind of see with electricity hookups and things like that. After that, judging it from the first time, we'll open it up to see as how many ever we get. We did have a food truck inquirer from Wichita that was interested in coming down. So I don't know, with the special event waiver that we have, they will have the $300 itinerant merchant license waived, so this will help. And Garden City does have a couple of success stories of food trucks actually becoming permanent locations. So the ideal behind this is for that to happen and for them to, gain a following and to be able to become a permanent location. Hopefully downtown too. So that's really what we've been working with in the last quarter in a nutshell. So any questions you guys might have?
I like seeing all the new promotions and things that are, the new activities and things that are going on downtown. I think it's important that that those become a routine so people get used to coming downtown's a place to go do something different and fun. You touched briefly at the beginning about membership recruitment. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit more about what the board's plans are for increasing the revenue from membership dues?
Sure, absolutely. So last night we met, and I gave, for the first month, I want each board member, our goal is to for them to approach at least five just businesses in the downtown core area, because believe it or not, we have a lot of businesses in the downtown core area that have never been members or have dropped away for so many. I think it'll be that that needs to be where our focus is at right now. And so they've been given packets. We revised our membership dues in the last year, taking things like that, and just getting out and our board members talking to them. I think, and you know, there's still a lot of people that for whatever reason don't know what we do, and that's on us. And so we need to really cover that communication gap. And I'm kind of making the board help out with that a little bit. So that's, you know, that's something that our board members are downtown. They're, you know, downtown business owners, and who better to know the community and their neighbors and can talk to them. And they'd be surprised just how many times you just don't think to talk about it. And so getting them involved, I think, is really going to help. You know, if things go well, that's great, but we're not going to quit looking at it. It's got to be something that becomes a staple of everything we do.
Mm-hmm. And what kind of actions are being taken to maintain your current membership?
So recruitment, retention, things like that, just visiting the members, having committee members visit them, and then that's, you know, on my part too, staff, getting out and visiting them, making sure that they, you know, any needs they have are addressed and things like that. That's probably something that we're going to look at next with the recruitment, but there has to be a retention piece to it as well. So that's a good question, and something that I can report back next quarter and let you know kind of some steps that we're taking on that.
Great.
We appreciate your support. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, item 12C. We're going to review the general fund revenues and discuss 2017 and 2018 capital improvement projects.
Okay. You could ask Lana to go ahead and talk about whatever the county so that can be part of this budget discussion.
You want me to skip to that one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so scratch 12C for a second. We're going to go to 12G so that you can incorporate that into your 12C discussion. 12G is President of Finney County Economic Development Corporation. Lana Duvall will present the second quarter report for 2017 with the governing body.
I guess they don't. They're just sending me up here.
And also,
good afternoon.
Discussion.
And you had a copy of our quarterly report included in your agenda packet. Hopefully you've had a chance to review that. And as usual, we just try to update you on some of the prospects that we're working with, as well as some of the projects that are underway. Since a couple of the prospects right now that we're working with, as you all know, the numbering system at the beginning tells you what month that prospect became viable, the year, and whether it was the first, second, third, or fourth prospect of that month that came into being. So in March, we did submit two rail sort sites for an industrial project. We've not had any follow-up from them on that at this time, except that those sites are being included for their consideration. In December, we submitted five sites to a manufacturer. That's through a broker actually out of Salina, and he is continuing to promote our sites to that manufacturer as well. Excuse me. 816-1 was a project that came to us through the State Department of Commerce when they sent out an RFP. So just so you have kind of an idea of some of the projects that we're working on and where those prospects come from. Project-wise, I think you guys are all well aware that DFA Meadowlark is coming along well. We do need to talk to them about their signage. Apparently they had a call to our fire department, and when the call went up to go to Meadowlark, and none of them knew what Meadowlark was. They knew what DFA was, but they didn't know what Meadowlark was. So we've had a little discussion with them about that, so we can make sure that they're never held up in getting emergency services should they need them. Fortunately, it wasn't a real emergency either, so everything worked out fine. A lot of what we're spending our time on right now, obviously, is Starbond development and working through the little intricacies of that project. We're hopeful that we'll be able to present some additional information and some of the investor information, those types of things, to you in the very near future. And certainly feel confident that it will be a project that the Secretary of Commerce will feel good approving for our community. Transload facility continues. continues, and as Mr. Brazil mentioned yesterday, the county commission did take the farmland road, the portion that needs to be provided for locally. They did bring that up on their agenda, and they did take action to take those funds from the joint economic development and incentive fund that they hold at the county. In the past, anytime we've gotten to ask for funds from that jointly held fund, we've always made sure that the city was on board because they are joint funds, and we've presented it in that manner to the county commission. Typically, we act as the ask, if you will, to release those funds. Since they made the decision to do that, they felt it was very important that they had, again, had that consensus from you that we would typically take to them as part of the ask. So, again, I think it just speaks to the great relationships that we have between our governing bodies. So I'll let Mr. Grizzell take care of that, getting them a consensus, but I did tell them that I would bring that to you so you would be aware of why they were looking for that. Probably the biggest things we continue to hear, as we've said over and over, workforce is absolutely still a big issue. We have very low unemployment rate. It continues to hover around the 2.9 mark, which is exceptionally low. And pretty much anybody who is unemployed has some barrier to employment. Either they don't have a legal right to work, they don't have access to child care, is oftentimes the issue, or they have some relationship with perhaps our corrections department, and it's a little more difficult for them to gain employment. So we continue to focus on that, and we think everybody needs to have an opportunity to succeed in Finney County, and we certainly hope that we can continue down that path. Other issues besides workforce that really potentially hold us back in our growth would absolutely be housing, and you guys are very well aware of that, but that's definitely one of the larger concerns we face, and unfortunately all of it is connected, so we can go out and recruit workforce to the area, but then we have to have a place for them to live. So we're hopeful that some new ideas come up as we continue to look at that. We're visiting with some additional developers across the state and in other states that may have an interest in coming in and doing some development projects, but we don't ever seem to get ahead on that issue as much as we do on it. We continue to have issues. So other than that, our board does meet on the fourth Wednesday of every month right here in your chambers, and obviously anybody is welcome to attend that. Does anybody have any questions that I can answer?
Back on workforce, I know you've been going to some things, and I'd be particularly interested when we go to Fort Riley or whatever, and they have new programs, I think, where they're trying to bring in organizations to talk to soldiers and military people that are about to be leaving permanent duty. And so has that been successful at all? When you talked about some of the barriers, And besides those, but at any of these things, workforce and recruitment deals you go to, what are the successes and what are the barriers?
Yeah, so as far as the recruitment from the military, the separating military, a couple of things kind of impact that. Our experience tells us that the Fort Riley visits are more productive for the types of jobs that we have available here versus the Air Force, for instance. When they're separating, they typically have a much higher level of income that they're seeking. Many of them have higher level degrees, those kinds of things. So they're not as recruitable for the types of jobs that we're really trying to fill mostly out here. Now there's some shifting. At the end of the last presidential term, there was a big push to shed some of our military personnel. That has started to shift somewhat under the new president. So we're not seeing as many separations. We're seeing them actually try to get more of them to re-up and stay with the military. So we don't know how much that will affect our numbers in our ability to recruit, but I will tell you that Fort Riley has just been wonderful to work with. They are super committed to their military personnel. They really want to help them find a future, and certainly most of them are from other states. And as we talk to them, many of them just don't have opportunities to go home to. They are living, they come from areas where it, it's just not as economically vibrant as it is here. So we still feel confident that we'll have a good draw with those folks. It's just whether or not that pool will slim down a little now.
So I really think if we get people to come out here and try something, that a large percentage would like it and stay. And I wonder if there's a way to incent, or you know, is there any of that in place now?
Yeah, one of the things we talked about with our board when we initially started visiting with Fort Riley was that they go through a period of separation from the service. So it's a lengthy process. And what we've talked about was if we got a core group of them, 12, 15, 20 of them, very interested in at least looking at the community, you know, we think employers would probably pony up for that. They would help to contribute to bringing them out here, showing them the community, much like we do for industrial projects, manufacturing projects, giving them an idea of what the community is. So yes, I think there's some room for that. I think the greatergardencity.com website will help us with that as well. Anything that we can promote to them that helps them see the good things that happen in our community is going to be a positive as we look to recruit from really from anywhere, but certainly from the military too.
So when is that website going? Because I tried going to there and it says it's not up and running.
It's really close. Yeah, actually what's taking the longest is filling the events calendar, because again, we always, we love to hear, there's nothing going on. You know, we all know better because we can't get to everything that's going on that we should be at. But yeah, the events calendar is taking some time to get put together. They're trying to get as much of the community events listed in that one space as possible. So it shouldn't be long at all, though. And I get to see it on my side, and it's awesome. So you're going to love it.
So end of July, 1st of July?
Oh, it'll August. Be soon. First
of July then? Or?
They really had hoped to have it up this month.
Okay.
I think they're still on task to be able to do that.
It
is great, though. You're going to enjoy it a lot. Great stories on there.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Before you leave, I want to thank the county commissioners who became a partner with us, and I want to thank their effort, and I'm sure that the project will get completed, and it's certainly something needs to be.
And it's a great project. I mean, that took a lot of work from the joint entities to get that project secured for Finney County, and we're having to pay a pretty small piece to get as much of the benefit that we got from the state. So absolutely a great use of those funds.
It's going to be well worth it, and they stepped up to the bat real quick, because just a couple of weeks ago we had that joint meeting and discussed it, and had a meeting on Monday and signed off.
They're good. Thank you very much.
So, Mayor, if the commission and you want to maybe have a formal motion and second and vote on whether or not you wish to affirm the action of the Finney County Commission yesterday that they took relative to Farmline Road, that would be, I think, appreciated.
I think we need a quick explanation of what that is. So, okay. You know, you're the best person.
Probably.
What it is we're considering and voting on. We don't really have anything in front of us.
Yeah, so as you guys
had, out there to hear.
Sure, as you had discussed at the joint meeting, that there was potentially an opportunity to utilize the Joint Economic Development Incentive Fund that is held by the county, but you send money over. A good portion of the funds in that account actually right now are from the sale of the only piece of jointly owned property that we ever got the opportunity to sell for economic development purposes. So the TPNL proceeds, if you will, make up a large portion of the funds that are available right now in that Joint Economic Development Fund. So when we had initially talked with KDOT, made our presentation to secure the funding for the transload facility, we knew that Farmland Road would require some updates just simply because it hadn't been used nearly like it's going to be used again now for quite some time. So one of the things that we had asked specifically from KDOT was that they provide some funding to go towards a portion of that. Their only linchpin, if you will, on those funds was that we as a community would also contribute to the construction of that road. So fortunately, we were able to leverage about $1.5 million towards the Farmland Road upgrades. But that does
require then that the local match pay for the difference, which leaves us something over $900,000.
What is 900? How much?
930.
How much?
930.
I think that we also have to say that beyond just the road and transportation of vehicles, we put in an 8 or 12 inch water line running from the north to the south that's going to service those areas down there in Towns River View, which gives an opportunity for those areas down there and housing to tap on and have some good quality water from the city. So
there's a lot of
part of that package.
Absolutely. Well, and getting rid of, quite frankly, an eyesore that this community has gotten to look at for a very long time. There are a lot of great advantages to getting that project. Nonetheless, it's a lot of money, and we understand that. Do we think it's worth it? Absolutely. Do we think there are additional opportunities as a result of that development? Absolutely. I think we'll continue to see growth. We certainly promote that area for industrial and manufacturing growth on a regular basis. So we would be fully supportive of it, and we feel good about that ask.
Anybody else have any questions? If not,
With that, Mr. Mayor, I'd move that the City Commission be in support of the County Commission's use of those funds, $930,000, for the Farm Meadow project.
Second. So we have a motion and a second for the approval of Finney County using the money from economic development to help build the farmland road. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thanks, Lana, for the explanation.
On that, we'll go back to 12C, the review of the general fund revenues and the discussion on the 2017 and 2018 capital improvement projects. Melinda's going to handle both of those.
In your books, you've got a budget memorandum written by myself and Matt, and also some information on where you are with regard to the city's mill levy. We also have the general fund revenues to go through. And we were going to give you an update on the capital projects, what we have funded in the 2018 budget. I think what we'll start off with first is the memorandum, and then we'll go back to the revenues here in just a minute. But what we're looking at today will be the final piece of the presentation for the 2018 budget. Over the last several meetings, the City Commission has been presented with the proposed city manager's budget. The staff presentation at the June 20th regular meeting reviews the general fund revenues and concludes staff budget presentations. In addition, there has been a few changes to the final version of the 2018 city manager's proposed budget that we want to bring to your attention, and we have reflected these new worksheets in your notebooks. The changes are, in the fire department, we have we've reflected the full restoration of the equipment in the line item 6100.08 and reduced a few other items in the budget relating to operations. So all of that safety equipment is now in the equipment line item for 2018. In the social funding line item, we reduced it by $5,000. So that the funding for 2017 and 2018 are the same amount at $45,500. The next item is we have a commitment to the school district for a parking lot at Kenneth Henderson School. This has been a commitment that we had several years ago that we need to fulfill. We have extra funds in our work comp reserve that we can transfer into our capital improvement reserve fund, $250,000, that will fulfill that obligation to the school district. Then when we start getting the water from DFA, we need to set up a utility, and we're calling it a water reuse utility. That is going to be for 2018. For the time being, to set a budget, we put $1 million revenue in it and $1 million expense, just to have a budget set for that fund. Now, if we can go ahead and go back to the
general fund revenues. That will conclude all the presentations of the funds. The sheets look like this. Okay, so we started out, we had a cash carryover into 2017 of $5,776,318. The revenues that come into the general fund were largely dependent on sales tax. So you'll see consumer use tax both years at $1 million. We also have liquor consumption tax. That is a tax that is split between three different funds. It's split between Special Rec and Parks, the AFAC fund, and general fund. So each fund gets roughly $100,000. We projected our ad valorem tax for 18 at $3.9 million currently. The city sales tax, last year, we came in at $6.5 million. We are conservatively budgeting our sales tax this year and next year at $6.3. County sales tax last year was 3.816. We're currently at 3.8 both years in 2017 and 2018. Motor vehicle tax had a slight reduction in its amount that comes to the city. $450,000 this year, $347,000 next year. Going on down, we do have our franchise payments. Cable TV is $306,500. We're seeing a small reduction in that area, $230,000 last year. We're looking at $227,000 both years in 17 and 18. Gas utility franchise, we were at $397,000 last year. We're looking at roughly $410,000 this year, going down to $390,000 in the 18. Telephone franchise, as you all know, landlines are starting to go away. Last year we collected $54,700. This year we're projecting $48,000 both years. The rest of the revenues going down are department type revenues. Of course, you'll see cemetery spaces. For the police department, we have car storage and towing. Engineering fees, that amount will be when we sell our temporary note this year. We usually charge a 3% engineering fee and a 2% administrative fee. The temporary note is for the fire station, the water line, and Kansas Avenue is already done. So, going on to the next page, the gate receipts. That's the gate receipts from the zoo. We also have some other cemetery revenues there for grave openings and monument setting. And then we get into the fees that are mostly in our neighborhood development services. You've got your plat filing and rezoning. We do have the rural fire contracts. Last year we were on rural fire contracts, we were at $167,000. We're budgeting $180,000 both years in 17 and 18. That's a lot of that's based on, you know, fire runs and that sort of thing. So it's a little hard to predict, but we think the 180 is probably a good number. Municipal court is the next one of the larger items there. Last year it was $845,000. We're looking at $950,000 both years here for municipal court fines. If we go on down, we've got some new revenue line items for the big pool. 3301.27. We're looking at $63,000 coming in on admissions, and on concessions, $3301.28, $25,000 both years. We've probably already exceeded that. But.
Yeah, I think we're gonna exceed both of those numbers. I wasn't sure, but I think it's gonna be good.
So we'll have some better numbers after one season on this. So we'll, but that's a placeholder for us for this year. Then we get into all of our licenses. The larger ones being your license for contractor, $32,000 this year, $33,000 next year. On the next page, building permits, $3,400.01. We're looking at, well, last year we were at $401,000. This year we're looking at a trend going around $200,000 this year and hopefully $245,000 in 18. Then you've got your permits going down here that are mainly issued by the neighborhood development services office. We do have rental for some of our city facilities here. We're getting repayment from Tech Vet. That's at the very bottom, repaying a loan that they had for some expenses that we incurred remodeling their facility out there at the airport. On the next page, the reimbursement of administrative costs, that goes along with the temporary note. Reimbursed police services, this line item is used for the billings that we send to USD 457 for services for our officers that are in the schools or any other after-hour game type security. The utility funds reimbursement, this comes from the electric, water, and solid waste. It's a reimbursement for salaries that are in the city manager's office and the salaries in service and finance. It is also the 5% franchise fee that any other utility would charge to have services in Garden City. That amount comes from the electric, water, and solid waste. We get a reimbursement from the county for the neighborhood development services projects that they do for the county. We also have a reimbursement from Holcomb for the same thing. Animal shelter reimbursement, that is from Finney County. That is to repay one-third of the costs that we have for the Humane Society. That contract is right at $216,000, so they're paying a third of that. And then some miscellaneous revenue going down. In 2016 and 2017 last year, during our budget talks, we had a transfer from the health insurance reserve that you authorized. In 2016, that amount was $330,000. In 2017, we were able to reduce the amount down due to staffing at the Rec Commission, down to $265,000. In 2018, the amount that they need is $303,500. That is not shown in your 2018 approved. That is something that you have to authorize for the city to take that from the health insurance reserve. If you do, that will be reducing your
mill levy. How much is that going to be approximately?
About a mill and a half, $303,500. So if that can come into play, we've got some calculations that we can show you in a little bit. If you would approve that transfer. We can either talk about it now or talk about it later. The fund currently has $1.7 million in it.
Aren't we obligated by state statute to fund that?
Yes.
So we might as well do it.
And we have a place that has funds that you can utilize for now.
Okay. Make a motion we approve the transfer.
$303,500.
I'll second.
That motion is second to pay the transfer of $303,500 from the insurance reserve to the rec. Any other comments or all in favor say aye.
Aye.
That concludes the revenue presentation. 2017 total revenues in the general fund, $23,321,182. And in 2018, we're at $23,788,813. So now we can go back to the memo. So as we're getting closer to adopting the 2018 city budget, we wanted to emphasize some important characteristics that your proposed budget has before you. The water and wastewater utility rates are forecasted at the existing rate ordinance. The electric utility rates are forecasted at the existing rate ordinance. The solid waste utility rates are forecasted at the existing rate ordinance. The only one that we're going to need to be looking at would be the proposed budget does not forecast a rate increase for the stormwater utility for 2017. You're going to be seeing some new rates at your second meeting in July for a rate increase for the stormwater utility that will reflect the infrastructure needs, but not the east side drainage at this point. The east side drainage, we propose doing that in a temporary note. Then that way you'll know the exact cost. And at that time, you can either look at a user fee for that or a ad valorem tax.
That's the two we're going to have for the polls.
Yeah.
And you said that's a 10-year note? Is that?
At this time it is?
Okay.
Yeah. And then we did create the water reuse utility for 2018. On the next page, the proposed budget uses conservative estimates for general fund revenues. We like to do that. That way, in case you have somewhat of a windfall, you'll have a bigger cash balance going into your next budget year. Your reserves are budgeted at balances that are in line with your financial management guidelines. That would be your utility funds and your community trust and also your general fund. Capital projects from the CIP are listed, are proposed to be funded or not funded, and we have those sheets here that we're going to go through here in a minute on your capital project. We do have in the proposed budget, a 2% salary pool budgeted for, and then also the pool for the step and grade in the police department. A 2% salary pool represents about $300,000 increase in the taxing funds over 2017. So that's about a mil and a half. We kept the city's contribution for health insurance for each employee at $820 a month. The proposed budget has 345 authorized positions, same level as 2017. So now, with the information that you've been presented so far, there's an additional $914,176 collected in ad valorem tax. This is in this table down here. If you look at table one, the mill levy worksheet, the general fund is looking at $4,037,815. That's a mill levy of 20.132. Bond and interest, $2,023,659, mill levy of 10.09. Airport, $737,736, mill levy 3.678. Recreation Commission, $1,002,840, mill levy is right at 5 mills. This gives you a total of 38 mills. 38.901 mills for 18 and a difference of 2.443 mills over 17. You just recently made a change with the health insurance reserve. That amounts to a mil and a half. So you're slightly under 1 mil currently. Slightly, yes.
So it'll be 1.19.
1.19.
Well,
I was adding some of
that
back in. Yeah. You're about a 0.9 with just the transfer from the health reserve.
Okay.
But since we had a change here today on Farmland Road, you were proactive in funding that project in your bond and interest fund. And so that did carry a debt service along with it on $930,000. So the debt service on it is roughly $125,000. So that's a slight reduction there. So if we can go through some of these items, I just want to make sure that you're comfortable with your budget. If you want to add something in or take something out, we have every opportunity to do that. It's not going to be set in stone today, but if it is, great. And if it's not, we can prepare couple of different ways with some options for you. But right now, the City Commission has a, you know, like I said, you have a number of options, and we have some targets that we'd like to hit. One of these items that we wanted to address, are you comfortable with the positions that you have in the City of Garden City? Or does the Commission want to add any of the four positions requested by the departments in the general fund? Human Resources had one, Zoo had two, and Fire had one.
We have 345 authorized positions. What do we average?
I think it stays pretty consistent.
No, but I mean, it's actually, you know, with vacant position, you know, with all the, in 345, you have vacancies. How's that? Do we average like 340 full-time equivalents or something like that?
It all depends on the year you want to look at, because right now we're pretty fully staffed.
Yeah.
So,
I think in 2013, I think we had 303 employees.
Right.
We have jumped up almost 40 people.
Yeah. So when you look at, you know, what we have for advertisements in the paper, you know, we're filling them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not, they're not sitting vacant. So this year I would say probably maybe between 335 and 340. We can go through all these questions first, and then if you, we can go back to them.
Okay.
We cut a project in the IT department, $26,200 for a K1000 network management, which would provide the ability for the IT staff to remotely manage computers across the network. That's another item. Does the commission wish to appropriate the full amount of the network infrastructure standardization project in 2018? Currently now we have $60,000 funded in 2018, and we're going to be obligated in 2019 for the additional $100,000. Then the commission, would you like to add $104,000 to complete the document imaging project in municipal court? The next question, does the commission wish to transfer money from the health insurance reserve? We've already answered that, so we can move on. Are there projects in the CIP list that are listed that are not being done that you would like to add? We'll come back to that one in a minute. We have those sheets that we can go through. Are there projects on the CIP that are listed that are being done that you would like to discuss the possibility of either delaying? So that can go along with that. And then, is there a target mill levy to which the City Commission would like to direct the staff to hit as we prepare the notice of hearing?
Zero.
Okay. The target, you know, I look through these items here, the network management and some of the other things. The number one I think that should be funded is the 303-500 where they were microfilming for the court.
$104,000.
I think that's very important to help them, and we're just falling behind every day on that. And they're, how many years behind are they now? About 20 years. So they got a lot of work.
What are they?
They're taking
now?
Old records and
yeah.
Scanning them.
Yeah, I know, but they can store them.
That's it.
Are you talking about municipal court? So basically the rule in municipal court is that we are required to keep records for 30 plus years. Some of them are longer, it just depends. But we have, so we have them stored downstairs in the basement and in several other locations. Some are in closets at the PD. And so the other thing that we're required to do is background checks. So if you come to the window at municipal court and you say, I need a copy of my background, and your background may include cases from 1980, from 1990, from 2000, from 2001, we have no idea where any of those are. So then we go downstairs and we start looking for boxes. Which box is it in? They take everything out of the box, look through, find that document. That's 1 year. Then they go and look for another one. And so when you say that we're looking, they see about 6,000 to 6,500 cases a year, those all get stored. And so then when someone comes in for a background check, and they do lots of these weekly, they have staff members who are spending 3 and 4 and 5 hours of their time searching through boxes. And so what this would do is it would put it into, that's the only way you can destroy those records, is if you have them scanned in. And so then if they scanned them in, then all they have to do is when someone comes for a background check, they walk in, they look for that person's name, they print all of those documents, and they give them their background check. The other thing that it's used for is if attorneys call from other jurisdictions, we have to provide them with previous convictions, whether that be for driving while suspended, no valid DL, DUIs. They're looked up the exact same way. They go to those boxes, they get them out, they copy them, that sort of thing. So that's how it works.
Basically, over a period of time, it's going to compensate for the reduction of salary hours.
Yeah.
By employees.
Yeah.
I like that. I would like us to do that one. I'd also, my consideration would be on the 26,200 in the K-1000. I think that is probably good, but something that could probably be delayed because it's more of a luxury than it is mandatory to have that.
Isn't there other ways to go to somebody's computer? I mean, I've got them buying a network management system.
You mean to remotely log into them?
I mean, I do it all the time. I mean, I've got people that get on my computer from Salina, Kansas. And
they probably, they probably have a software that allows them to do that. You may not have the software, but they have it as part of their business. Exactly. So what this is for our IT department, which would be that business that you're talking about, to have that so that they can log into, they can remotely access, say for instance, there's a problem at the electric service center.
Right.
Then they can remote access into that computer rather than sending someone out there to go work on it. Yep. Or on the weekends when we have people on call, or in the evenings when we have someone on call, having them remote into their computer rather than coming in and working.
I thought there was other systems.
Sorry, Ashley, I didn't realize you were behind me.
Clay would actually be the better person to talk about this, but he's downstairs in IT working. So we do have the ability to remote access in the computer management software, the K1000. What it does is allows us to push updates to all of the computers at one time. So we're not remote accessing into each of the 304 computers on our network. We can do those all at the same time. And right now, a lot of people, it falls on the individual user themselves to do those updates. So a few weeks ago, we had a problem, or there was a problem, I don't know that we experienced it, but with a crypto virus going around that was encrypting people's desktops. Well, Windows had pushed an update that would secure your computer to prevent that from happening, but most of our users hadn't gone in and installed that update. So they were still vulnerable. What this would do would allow IT to go in and do all of those updates from at one time rather than individually going into each of the 304 computers and making sure that everybody has the updates that they needed to do. And I'm sure it has other features as well. I don't know what those are. I can text Clay and have him come up here if you guys are interested in that. But it isn't just remote access.
It's more, and it's kind of like preventative maintenance, because in the long run, if you have a whole pile of computers that are infected, it's going to cost a lot more money to fix that than if we spend this amount now.
Sure.
So are these amounts, are they already, I can't remember, are they already in the budget?
The 26.2 is not.
Okay.
It was removed. The 104,000 was removed for the scanning project. The 100,000 to go along with the 60,000 on the infrastructure stabilization project will be a must in 19.
Okay.
19.
Yeah.
At least those are some things that we need to think about and discuss here maybe later on after we go through the list here. Your question was, what are we looks over here, everything on the board right now is about 20 mills or levies. Is that what it is, or is it higher than that?
That's just that 20 mills is just that one category.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That's a general fund.
That's a general fund, so that's 2.443 mills.
And we just made a recent reduction of 1.5 to that with the transfer from health insurance.
To be the same, we just got to basically bring that down to zero if we're going to be like we were last year. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, so we have to, we're right now at about a mill and a half. So are we happy with a mill and a half, or do we want to go with a zero or some other figure in between?
Right now, you're right under one.
Yeah. Right at one.
You're right under one.
Reduced it. Okay.
And that's without those things we just spoke of.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
We had those back in.
Yeah. Actually, while we're thinking about that, we're talking about mill levies. There's proposed on funding for $350,000 for reconstruction of 8th Street. Now, that's something that we haven't funded yet, but
no.
That's something that's probably going to come up.
I think I'll call Sam up here, and we can go through this summary that we have on the 2017 and 2018
okay.
capital improvements, so you know exactly where you're at with your capital improvement program.
He's on his way here.
See, he's on his way coming up to the podium.
He's here. Slow, but he's
I don't have that list one.
Oh, I gave you mine. We're going to start with 2017.
Hey, which projects do you want to talk about on those?
Probably the ones that are not funded. Make sure you're okay with the status on those.
If you start with the fire department, you have the East Fire Station number 3. That's not funded. Heroes Way, which is a downtown project. You guys talked about that earlier. The indoor shooting range police department project. Down here, you got the public restrooms as a project. Southeast Community Park Improvement, that is the development of Southeast Park. That would be the trees, irrigation, grass, parking lot for phase one. Phase two would come in 18, which is another 400 and some to build the restroom community building.
Where is that?
That would be in 18. 17 is just the one for the development of the grass, trees, irrigation, and parking lot.
Where?
Where is it located?
No.
That's what he's asking.
Oh, off of Spruce and the bypass. Over by the
new housing.
Yeah. New housing over there. Okay. The Clint Leitner renovation is tearing down the old concession restrooms and building a new, maybe possibly adding locker rooms to that facility for the high school. And then the skate park, that one's been in there a few years, is not funded. And then if you go to 18, you're looking at the fire station, which is, I guess in 17 is the design, and in 18 was construction, but I think you guys were talking about combining those probably if you did something with a sales tax or something like that. The golf is a maintenance area. That's some pavement over by their maintenance facilities. Redesign of the 18th hole. The multi-purpose sports facility plan. That's something that we've talked about, is coming up with a concept on that. But I believe also the Star Bond is something that would play into that too. The FEMA study and drainage improvements, We have not been contacted by FEMA, so that's just kind of a place marker setting out there in case we have to do something because of FEMA. Mainline rehabilitation is on storm system. I was trying to propose that in the budget. This is still just a place marker. We're going to be coming to you here in the near future with possible rate increases. That's the maintenance side of the rate increases. We was also looking at a project, but I believe that would be an option too. Reconstruction of 8th Street. That is from St. John's to Buffalo Jones, Walnut, reconstructing that area. We're proposing concrete. That is one of the projects that will be coming to you for a possibility of using the federal exchange funds for. You need to decide what project you want to do for the federal exchange project. That's one of them that's being considered. Reconstruction of North Campus. That's campus from Mary Street North to the bypass. Had a lot of construction going on in that area. That pavement just didn't hold up. And that would either be a one-time, pretty expensive project, or you could break that into phases in the future. We did seal it this year to try to put a Band-Aid on it a little bit longer to give you some time to decide what you want to do with that street. Hopefully that will preserve it for another couple years. Here's the other Southeast Community Park improvement that I was talking about. That would be the completing the project with restrooms. I believe there's spray park in there, a playground, and then also a community building to hold outdoor concerts. Provided another venue for that type of event for the community. Jenny Barker Road reconstruction. You know about that project. We've been talking with the county about that one. Clint Leitner renovation. That is moving their maintenance building. That's in the south or northeast corner and moving it over to the south east corner to get it out of the visual and provide a better access for the maintenance crew and get it out of sight. The Clint Leitner scoreboard, that is a project that we're currently working with the school district, WINS, and the REC to try to come up with some funding to replace that scoreboard at Clint Leitner. And then the Fancer Field renovation, we've already did one big project there to get the field playable for high school and college play. This would finish that project up. One of the big things would be the lighting around that complex. Right now, we can only play during the day. I know the high school would like to see lights up there so that we can play into the evening hours. That would also rebuild your dugouts, bullpens, and build a batting cage there to complete that complex. And then the last three that are on here are the zoo projects for the tiger exhibit, flamingo, and primate. And you visited a little bit about that already today.
Hospital at the zoo, it says 15,000 Friends of Lee Richardson Zoo. Is that funds that they're going to allocate towards this, or what does that mean?
I believe they're assisting with some funds.
That was 15,000 we were going to go out and get a grant. It's not Friends money.
Okay. Okay.
It's a grant that we haven't acquired yet.
Okay.
Sam, let me run something by you. It's something that I've been thinking about for several months. I've never really been satisfied with the downtown revitalization, $250,000 a year, where it goes. And overall, it went to good pro- projects. We've got maybe a couple more years left in that. I would like to see that $250,000 maybe this year and next year, just put it down on 8th Street, down there where all those businesses are, and give them some little improvements down there rather than little spots here and there wherever it needs it downtown.
That would be a good question for Caleb.
They're eligible to apply for this.
Yes. Yeah. Well, they can apply for that, but I'm not talking about putting glass and windows and doors. I'm talking about maybe doing sidewalks, putting in lights, flower pots, whatever it would take to beautify that. That could also help with the construction. If in 2 years, $500,000 do quite a bit just in the street work down in front of there.
I'm not sure we'll have that after.
But
17, 18.
There's funding that's available for streets.
Okay, but that yeah. can also assist us. But I think that Mike even had brought it up to us earlier. Those people are complaining. They're not getting what they're getting there, and yet they're in the core. So I think if this is the last year for $250,000, let's put it down there.
I think we've already allocated for this. I mean, this year the plan is to use it at the downtown development fund. We can change it next year.
Yeah, for 18. Yeah.
But I think there's money available to do a lot of that work on 8th Street through
the federal exchange
yeah.
fund. And when we do reconstruct that, we were looking at concrete, and we would look at the curb and gutter. We would look at sidewalks. We also need to somewhat realign Stevens Avenue, so we would put all that into that project.
Okay.
But then
going back to what you said, you thought it was already realigned or allocated. Does that mean, are we obligated? These people may have picked up an application, but we've not taken no action on that yet.
I don't think they've taken.
No, but it's my understanding we allocated, set aside $250,000 to go for these for projects that are in this process, I mean, that are qualify for the Downtown Development Fund. And I'm assuming it goes through the end of the year. And then if there's money left over, sure, I'm sure we can do whatever we want
to. The project on 8th Street would be the same as the project that but it's not 8th Street.
Yeah.
Well, they're
but
all part of
all
it.
The same. It's all
yeah.
downtown.
But so, why don't we just dump the whole $250,000 in there and do a good job and get her started?
Because I feel like that we would be reneging on what we said we would do.
We haven't reneged because they haven't submitted and we haven't approved.
Have we have submittals?
They're talking about 8th Street, that area.
As far as, I believe we've only had 3 applications this year and we have 1 that'll be coming before you. So that's the only ones and I'm not sure. I don't have the numbers in front of me to know what total allocation has been spent on those, but
that's one, and we haven't made a decision
that's
on,
right.
on
that's
any
right.
of them. So we depends on what the number one that comes for us first. If we decide we want to do that, but we could also, or whatever's left, we could put on 8th Street. But
yeah, you can choose to do whatever you want with
that, right.
that funding. It's just that you know, you'd have to handle how those applications. Yeah. come to you and how you would want to handle those, but I believe there's 2 that have been funded this year so far out of it, and a 3rd that's in the process.
And there may be people out there know that this is available and are banking on it, but just haven't brought it forward to us yet. I just feel like we need to give them that opportunity before we use that money else differently. It's just my opinion.
Just a thought I had. I just felt that those people, whether we've done a couple things for them, but the streets, the sidewalks, everything could certainly be addressed, and that would be an easy amount of money if we got there to be able to do those things with.
And I think you guys can address that. I think if we're talking about the same funds being allocated in different places, it doesn't necessarily affect the things that Melinda's asking you with the CIP projects and this sort of thing. So I don't think it's something you have to really hone down at this moment because it's the same exact amount that you're talking about.
I think that the no's on here is what we're, are we all right with this?
Are you all right with that?
Exactly, exactly, the things that Melinda has brought to you. Are you okay, and I think what she was asking was, are you okay with the no's, but then are you also okay with the yeses? Or do you want to remove any of the yeses to cover other expenses or to change where you're at, ultimately?
Well, but I think we've agreed to a lot of the yes stuff already. I mean, a lot of the stuff that's yeses, we've kind of already been approved and we're moving forward on, so I'm fine with the no's where they're at. I mean, that's...
We've got time to look at it some more.
Where's it going to come from?
What are we going to do with this 26? It's $130,200. That's this 104 plus 26.2 for the K1000 network management.
Yeah, you recall they gave the presentation the last meeting or the meeting before on the
document
scanning. We've got three rooms around the city full of documents.
Is that a project that you would like to see?
I would like to see it happen.
Okay.
Is that buying an imaging machine or subbing it out?
It's a company that they will send all of our boxes to. They will image everything and they will send it back to us.
And that includes all the shipping and
it includes everything.
Right.
Yep.
And then as we go forward, everything will be electronic.
Yeah.
Even new cases then.
You can search for it. Basically.
And our staff, as they mentioned, has already scanned in. They've emptied out their file containers. They're no longer using files in court. So as a case comes in, they're no longer creating files. Everything is electronic. It's just the old stuff. So they've kind of done the hard part. It's just
getting the rest
of it in there. The number of people it would take to scan all that stuff in is who knows, and who knows if they would even do it right.
The network remote management, you know, if somebody has to go out to 304 computers,
over
time, that those kinds of expenses should repay themselves and saved salary, you know,
what would
positions.
That add mill-wise if we had those two projects?
Well, we've got another project to talk about that you can remove from your debt service, and that's farmland. So, to summarize here, we have the health insurance transfer at $303,500 that's going to be added to revenues. And if we add in the municipal court scanning project at $104,000, and then if we remove the debt service from farmland, if we remove that, would you like to add a project into the debt service that you've seen?
No.
I say it. That zeroes out, isn't it? Maybe more.
Can we hear a little bit more about the network management? Now that you're here, memory, please.
So the K1000 enables us to manage patches and updates to programs that currently now we have to go out and do manually one by one. This gives it all in a certain place. We say, make sure this program is up to date on all the city computers. Does it for us. We don't have to just sit there and watch it. It takes care of that. It also allows us to put programs that employees can go on there and install themselves. They don't have to call us. They just go to the website, they click install it, it does everything for them. So it cuts down a little bit on that time too. It also allows us to keep better track of what's out there. Because when we do it, the computer will be checking in, so we know the computer's there, we know it exists, we know when it stops talking. Before somebody may notice that, hey, this computer over here in the corner isn't working and we need this. Well, you know, it may not work for a couple weeks, but nobody noticed. And now we can kind of stay on top of that kind of stuff.
So do you, I know this is a reach, but do you have any idea how many man hours this would save your staff?
I mean, we spend at least a couple hours per person a week doing updates or installing programs for people around the city. So figure in, there's about four of us that do it, so you've got, we sometimes have more with the PD, with their in-cars, their computers in the cars, we gotta pull them in every so often to do updates on them, so some weeks we spend, we do that all week, that's about all we do, so.
So it's $26,200 up front, is there a minimum annual maintenance?
That is, that's for 3 years, so there'll be, there would be a cost after 3 years, but that's, I believe, for the 3-year price.
Wow, so that.
That would, and the cost is only, 10%, something like that, it's just a maintenance cost.
No, the 26 gives you 3 years.
3 years.
Mm-hmm, so.
When you do that, you have to do it at night when everyone's on the computer?
We can schedule it to say, yeah, when there's, you know, there's nobody on, go ahead and do all the updates.
They have to be off the line before you.
No, we can do it when they're there working too.
They can still work.
Mm-hmm, yep.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not like us where right now we have to kick them off to do the update. They could go on the background, they may even never know it did it.
So you have some indirect labor savings even that way. It's mm-hmm. A lot of taking a break by the IT.
So that's about $8,700 a year, divided by that amount, divided by three, and that almost equals.
What that cost for 3 years?
Yeah,
but that almost equals your staff hours, you know, the salary that you would pay.
You're still paying them.
But
whether they're doing that or something else, I mean, I don't, you're not saving any money, I don't think. I think
you're still adding,
but it's you're more efficient, I will say that.
And we can work on other stuff.
We still got to pay you. Okay?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's not like we're going to start running and then go home.
Right. Yeah. So I think the way to look at it is, you know, it does make it more efficient.
It would.
And, you know, as you add more computers and all this, I mean, it gets to be a bigger problem.
Mm-hmm.
When it starts costing is when you have to add another person
right
to your department. That's a big cost.
Quick question back on the 100, on the document imaging.
Uh-huh.
Do we have to save those documents then once we get them imaged?
No.
Do we have to have a hard copy?
No.
Then,
no, that's part of the laws that we can actually destroy them at that point. And this part of that cost is they're destroying them as well. So we won't get them back.
Just making sure that we aren't scanning and then we have to store them.
No.
Because I know on some things you have to have hard copies, so I was just making sure we didn't.
No.
That wasn't part of the deal.
Just the cost to destroy them is going to be pretty expensive.
I wouldn't want to have to destroy them. I wouldn't want to have to destroy them.
So, do you have a number for us then? If we added those back in?
Okay, so.
Thank you.
Here we are. Health insurance reserve transfer at $303,500. Add in the scanning project of $104,000. Add in the management system for IT, $26,200. Take out farmland road debt service of $116,000. That gets you at 37.547 mils, up 1.089. The 0.089 we can find, it's $17,850. So you'd be up one mil.
If you can find 17,000.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay with increasing by 1 mil.
I can live with that.
Mm-hmm.
We've given the staff direction on how to prepare the notice of hearing. We will have it prepared at a 1 mil increase for 2018 at your next meeting. We still have time to make, until we publish, we can make all kinds of changes. So you can make all kinds of changes on
the We just can't, we can go down, but we just can't go up.
Once you publish.
After publish, right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, at the meeting of the 6th, we'll have a 1 mil up on your 2018. And like I say, we can make any changes we need to. I have to have it to the paper by Friday to publish on Saturday. Public hearing will be July
20th.
On the scanning document imaging, was there any opportunity to break that up? Maybe we talked about that a couple of
So they, after it came before the commission the first time, Jared went back and kind of discussed what other options we would have with them. We can actually send it all up front and then pay it in payments, or we can't. So that would be one option, and I think it was maybe broken into 2 years.
Could we get that in two budget cycles?
Yeah, they actually gave us three different options.
Okay.
We can do, we pay up front, do it all at the same time. We can basically set it off, have them do it, and then pay the one lump sum within 12 months. So either way, it's going to fall within one budget cycle. Or we can go to 24 monthly payments or 36 monthly payments. It's going to increase a little bit on that bid price if we do the longer payment. 24 months would be an increase of $10,648, and 36 monthly payments would be an increase of $13,432. So those are our options they gave us as far as financing down the road. They also have an option where, as long as we commit to send them every box, we can do it box by box, and they give us a price per box. And so we send 20 boxes, 40 boxes, 60 boxes, and as long as we keep it coming, they'll keep doing that project. And so it's kind of a way around doing the full financing of 36 monthly payments. We just send them so many boxes at a time, and they would continue to work that at a price per box, which would be the equivalent of the $104,000.
So the longer it takes for them to do it, and they would have our material there, we have a waiting period or a lapse in there that we don't know anything about on these people if we're doing background. So I think the whole goal here is to get it done as quick as possible, because they can, I'm pretty sure they can probably transfer and start transferring that data to you as they're probably putting it together.
What was the time frame if you did it all at once? What was the time frame in which they would have it done?
They would have it done in a matter of weeks, they said. They can actually get it done within a couple months.
And that's not bad. It's a delay of getting a background that may depend on somebody else.
Well, and that's reasonable. Most courts are going to say that that's reasonable. Most people are going to say that a couple weeks waiting for something to come back is reasonable.
And they have an option, too, where if somebody came in and needed something, we can shoot them an email or call them, and they find that document for us and do that one right away and send it back to us within the 72 hours that we would need to be able to fulfill that.
I think we have to pursue just doing it as fast as we can at $104,000, get it there, get our information back, let them destroy it. We're on our way.
It's fun to us.
But you said that if we send it to them in batches, it would still be the 104. It would just be spread out for a
while. They explained it to me. They give us a quote per box. Okay. They break down 104,000 per box that we have. And so to accommodate some facilities that don't want to send it all at one time, they can do 20 boxes or 40 boxes as long as we commit to give them the whole project in its entirety. How exactly that works out with them, I'm not sure. They just said that's an option.
Okay.
But if we did the project all up front, we could actually, they would do the whole scanning project, and then we would just pay them in the 24 or 36 months. So they could do the whole project quick as they can either way, and then we just finance it differently.
And they want all the boxes at one time. They only want to make one trip out here to get the stuff.
I'm sure they'd be happy with that.
Yeah, so I'm good with that project.
If we put that money in the 2017 budget, could it all get done in 2017, or would you rather have it be budgeted for 2018?
If they approved it for this year, they are ready to go immediately, and we would ship it off here within the next few weeks.
And it could get done by the end of the year?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm missing. You're proposing to pay for it in the current budget, mm-hmm. and not so we're now that's not a consideration in the 2018 budget.
Well, I'm just. It's still, it's part of your cash carryover that goes into 18. It all depends on if you want to do it this year or next year. He had it proposed for this year. You guys want to talk about tax lift?
Well,
because I'm kind of happy about it.
We didn't hit it, though.
What's the mark where we would have to?
Okay, so we did the calculation yesterday after we had some pretty good numbers to look at. Of course, there's a lot of changes in the calculation. You take in the, you see the county information that I put behind the memo that shows your valuation, shows your property added, has a lot of information on it that we use for the calculation of the tax lift. New to it this year is the exemptions for debt service. So you have information that you put in for 2018 on your debt service, and then your 2017. And then the difference between those two is what you get to add into your taxes. Then you have to look at your law enforcement expenses from 2017 to 2018. We did have an increase there with the CPI of $245,391. Then you have to look at fire department expenses. With the CPI adjustment, we're up $33,834. So we had total increased tax revenue adjustment of $467,000. Added on to last year's total taxes collected, your base would be $7,804,879. So as of yesterday, before we made any adjustments, we were $2,000 under that. And now we're, you know, close to $400,000 under that. So you will not have to have a public election on your budget. So you're, and even no notice in the paper. So you did a great job. Not only did you guys do a good job, but Matt and I were very pleased with, you know, the amount of input and staff effort that we get from our department heads on running their budget. We have advisory boards that spend a lot of time in the citizen-based capital improvement planning process that engages our citizens on the front of and end of the budget cycle. So the city department heads, with their tremendous work in managing their budget, examining expenses and revenue trends, engaging in employees at all levels of the organization to provide input, and ultimately developing the city commission's consideration for responsible and financial service delivery strategies. And as you know, your commissioners, it's not easy with all of the work that we do here in the city. It's not easy to get all this done, but you've got some great department heads, and we really appreciate all of the advice you give us as city staff members. So
we thank you.
You make our job easy.
You got the information you need.
I appreciate all your time today. We did a lot of work today. So
and then we have wiggle room under that, so
I think, you know, reducing that some more should still be a goal. Yeah, mm-hmm. We can come back with that discussion for this evening.
Very good.
Okay. Well, on that note, we'll move on to 12D. The governing body is asked to consider and approve task order number 7 between the City of Garden City and HNTV for planning services for the terminal area plan project at the Garden City Regional Airport, Airport Improvement Program, AIP 3-20-00-24-40. Rochelle?
All right, well, good afternoon. So this is our second AIP project for the year. Typically, we stay around $1 million because that's our entitlement funding. So this is our second project. It's going to look at the current infrastructure of the terminal, including access to the terminal, the building components, landside and airside facilities, and from that, it's going to do like an inventory. It's going to look at the forecast, aviation forecast, demand capacity for the airport, and have a component of a committee that's going to do a planning advisory committee to review all this information. Ultimately, they'll come up with 3 to 4 recommendations for renovating the airport terminal and or construction of a new terminal with costs associated with that. And then finally present a final recommendation to be approved by the City Commission. So that incorporates this project. It's 90% funded by the federal government and 10% from the city. From this planning process, which will take about 9 months, the recommendation will go into next year's AIP project, which would be the design of that. So the task order basically is for the services provided by HNTV, which is the airport engineering firm that we use.
And where are they from?
Kansas City.
Mm-hmm. They did the master plan.
Correct.
A
yeah.
few years back.
Okay. They've provided services to us for about, I think, 8 to 9 years now.
I make a motion we approve task order number 7.
Second.
We've had a motion and a second to approve task. Garden City Regional Airport Improvement Program. Any other discussion? None, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. Passed.
Thank you. 12E, the governing body is asked to consider and approve a contract between the City of Garden City and the Kansas Water Office. The purpose of the agreement is to gauge the feasibility of a large conversion of irrigated public grounds from the Ogallala Aquifer to treated effluent utilizing subsurface drip irrigation technology.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners.
Hi.
Hi. This is a project we've already bid. It's already underway, but we were approached by the Kansas Water Office with some financial assistance to offset our share of the grant that we're paying. Currently, our cost project matching funds is $131,180.77, and the Bureau of Reclamation is contributing $92,250. So we would apply the $15,000 that would be received from the Water Office at the completion of this project. We'd apply that to offsetting our matching funds. And then in 2018 and 2019, we've agreed to provide some follow-up reports to them regarding the changes in water use and our experiences with going with this conversion. The Water Office is interested in this project basically to do, they spend a lot of time and effort talking about other uses of water in western Kansas, primarily agricultural irrigation, and so they wanted to do some projects that also showed some things that municipalities could do to offset water usage. So it's just a companion to our project. And I do want to correct, someone pointed out there in the attachment B from the Water Office, it says 123,000 feet. That's the square footage of the baseball field. That's 2.8 acres. So I got my calculator out and calculated that. So we'll note that typo with them and assume otherwise everything will be acceptable to the commission if you so approve.
I move we approve the contract between the City of Garden City and the Kansas Water Office.
Second. We have a motion and a second to approve the contract between approve the subsurface irrigation demonstration area contracted by the Kansas Water Office and direct the Water Resource Manager to conduct preparation of the delivery with the Kansas Water Act.
Well, I said.
All in favor? Any other discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. Carried.
Thank you.
Item 12F, the governing body is asked to consider and approve two reappointments to the Zoo Advisory Board.
I make the motion we approve the reappointments to the Zoo Advisory Board.
I'll second.
We've had a motion and a second to approve the two applicants for the Zoo Advisory Board. Any other discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay.
And we have already handled 12G, so we will skip over that to 12H, the consent agenda for approval and consideration. I have two items on there. Number one being the governing body is asked to consider and approve the application for federal assistance for the terminal area plan project at the Garden City Regional Airport, Airport Improvement Program AIP 3-20-00-24-40. And the governing body is asked to consider and approve the contractor license for June 20th of 2017, and you can take those two items together.
I move that we approve consent agenda items H1 and 2.
Second.
Got a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda item H1 through 2. No other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. I guess we're now ready for the commission reports.
I just wanted to mention that I thought the pre-meeting was
Yeah, I also echo what Commissioner Finkhauser said on the pre-meeting. A lot of good information to kind of give us a good start on, you know, on, you know, proposing a, you know, a campaign for the sales tax. Like to congratulate Jennifer on getting through the meeting. She did a good job. We started out, you know, with our memo, we were almost at 2.5 mils and we got it down to 1 mil. So I, and then, you know, that gives us a little wiggle room to kind of look for other areas, you know, before we do publish. So, but good discussion, a lot of hard work by all the departments and, you know, putting, and, you know, us going through all of that, you know, it's a big task to do. And, you know, always trying to set a budget. It's, you know, one of the more daunting tasks that a commissioner has to go through and do, you know, sitting on this commission. But, you know, we have a great staff and we do a really good job at being good stewards of the taxpayer dollars that we do receive and trying to run a first-class city. So good job on all that we did today. Other one to mention that Beef Empire Days parade turned off really good. A lot of participants in that, and a lot of people turned out for that. And I just wanted to thank staff for all their hard work, and the police department and city crews for helping. You know, it takes a lot of extra officers and manpower for parades in our community, but we always seem to have a good turnout and great show. So I just wanted to congratulate everybody on that. And that's all I got.
Well, I too enjoyed the pre-meeting conversation about ways to fund paying for some of the public safety services that we need. Some of the things are quality of life and other things are important to our economic development. A way of finding ways to pay for that where the cost is spread out with people who come and enjoy our city, not just the property tax property owners in our community. So many of those projects need to be done and they're important to this community, and I just hope this all works out so that our community can continue to grow and be the regional hub. That's all I have.
Before I, you know, advocate for that, you know, I would just encourage the Garden City and Finney County folks to get engaged in all that, because there are a lot of some of those projects are needs and some of them are wants that are all great, and but you just can't do them all at once. And so, you know, there are different ways to pay for things. And so the biggest thing I think is just to learn about all the projects that are needed to be done and how we might pay for them, because as I think Commissioner Sessler did the addition and we were from 19 to 26 million or 23 million or something like that, depending on, you know, and so, you know, just those are big, big numbers, and they can't all be done at once, but there can be a long-term plan to get to some of them sooner rather than later, maybe. But a public vote, you know, is always a good thing to kind of gauge, and so if that's where we go with that, then great. And other than thanks to staff for all their hard work, whether it be parades or budgets or pre-meetings or all the other stuff, we, you know, there's just so much going on, and it takes a pretty dedicated group of people, so thanks.
Thank you. I want to make the same comment about the Beef Empire Day parade. It was well attended by the number of floats, I think, grow every year, but then the number of people, there's a tremendous amount of people go down there and watch that. I think the only parade that we have that there's more is at Christmas time. Really flock down there. That's good. I thought our pre-meeting was very good. It gives each one of us five many things to think about and go out there in the community and put your ear out there and see what happens. If the press was there today, they got the information. Hopefully there will be some enough articles in the paper that will create interest in it in the general population out there, guidance. Everything on there has an importance in one way or another, so at least if in fact and when the horse thief tax quarter is available, and if we are smart and have the ability to get the vote to approve that, could be a tremendous relief to our general fund as far as for years to come, because not only could you build certain things, but you could also use that money to continue to buy those items that we wouldn't have to buy in a normal fund from the general fund. So it's very important, and I hope that it passes and when we come up with whatever it is. I want to thank staff for everything that they've done. Jennifer, her work today, just for everybody in general. Without you, we couldn't do our job as well as we do, or I hope as well as we do. But at any rate, you know, we don't always agree, but that's what it's about. If we all agree, then we just have one person do it.
I might mention one more thing, candidates being here, to listen to all this, and I think it's helpful.
Have we picked a date for that candidate forum, or not the forum, but the
orientation? They did.
They already had that.
They had the orientation.
You had the orientation?
Mm-hmm.
Where were you?
Did you want to be oriented?
We had it on Monday the 12th.
June 12th.
Monday, June 12th.
No, I was going to attend.
You weren't invited.
No, he was invited.
I checked my